this morning to Center City Baptist Church. And thanks, guys.
You're welcome.
And girls. We appreciate it. It is a great day to be with y'all, a great day to be with the Lord. And it's New Year's Eve. Ta-da! It's New Year's Eve.
And the Cowboys won.
That's right. The Cowboys won last night. That's the rumor, anyway. It's one of those games where I feel like I'll go home today and they've reversed it.
You know? Probably will.
Timeout. Detroit won. It was a good ball game. Congrats to the Cowboys. And it's great to have all of you here in church. Great to have all of you watching this morning. You're in church, too. And let's see, I had a couple of things to say. Number one, the church gave my wife and I last week a very nice Christmas gift. And thank you. Thank you. Just thank you. Pat Burns, one of our dear ladies, passed away. And here are the details of Pat's service. Going to be at Stacy Wilkins. Going to be at 1 o'clock Tuesday afternoon. They will have visitation from 11 to 1 at the funeral home. And then the service starts at 1 o'clock, and interment will be, what's the name of the cemetery?
Center City.
Huh?
Center City.
Oh, it's going to be here or Goldway?
Here.
Center City.
Center City, across the street.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Now you know. Today is a great day for our church, the last day of the year, and we celebrate the Lord's Supper this morning together. And if the people participating would come forward, I would appreciate it. Let me read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It says in verse 27, so then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Let's take a moment and bow in silence and make sure that you're okay with the Lord. Amen. And the Bible says, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's pass the bread. be. Would you pray?
Heavenly Father, we pray this morning for your forgiveness, Lord, that we are so thankful for the fact that you sent your Son to die on the cross to save us all from our sins. Forgive us where we fail. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please partake. And the Bible says, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Let's pass the night. George, please pray.
Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you, Lord, for your Son, Jesus, that shed his blood on the cross, Lord. Even though we don't deserve it, we thank you for the forgiveness that was granted that day. Lord, we ask that you bless each one that's here and bless us and forgive us where we fail you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please partake. By saying, for whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Thank you. George.
Yes, sir.
Let's continue.
Okay, I've got a verse down here, the third chapter of Colossians, the 16th verse says, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. So we have gratitude in our hearts. Let's sing. What are we going to start with, Catfish?
We're going to start with number 206. Would y'all please stand for these first two? Number 206. Blessed be the name. Sing 1, 2, and 4.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, blessed be the name of the Lord, the glories of my God and King. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Name of the Lord. Jesus, the name that calls. Blessed be the name of the Lord. His music in the sinner's ears. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I never shall forget that day. Blessed be the name of the Lord. When Jesus washed my sins away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name.
Our next hymn is number 189, The Lily of the Valley, number 189.
He's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the wind forsake me, and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. From his manna he, my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory, rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Let us pray. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we're so blessed to be here and so thankful for everything we are blessed with. The most important, your Son who gave his life on that cruel cross for a debt that we can't repay, but we can open our hearts and give back to the way that is pleasing in thy sight. In Christ's name, amen. Amen.
Number 541, 541. Why do I sing about Jesus?
Shine through.
thank you very much. The musicians did a beautiful job, and I appreciate it. And so Christmas is history. And now we look forward, I hope, to a new year. A new year that I hope and pray will be one of the best that you've ever had. Someone said this is the time of the year for newness. And it is. Maybe some have a new watch or a new diamond you received for this Christmas. Then again, I haven't been outside, but somebody may have driven up in a new vehicle. Maybe you have new clothes on today. Right after Christmas, I pray we all have a whole bunch of new stuff. And then we have a new year. And what do people do during the new year? Well, they make resolutions, make new commitments as we seek to change things in the upcoming year. I'm not afraid to make a new commitment today because tomorrow it'll probably be gone. I won't have to feel bad about it for a long time. But we do. We make commitments. Why do we make commitments the first of the year? Well, to see how long we can keep them. That's it. One day, one week, one month. I've never made a month. But we do. We make resolutions and commitments because down deep, we want to change. We'd like to change. We'd like to be that person that doesn't do this or doesn't do that. And it's always found us up and we're sick of it. So I make a New Year's resolution. I'm not going to badmouth Mike Lee in 2024. I'm not going to pick on George in 2024 because he's big. No, but that's what people do. I want to wipe the slate clean. I want to make a commitment to do some stuff. And there's nothing wrong with that. Because we all want to change and we all need to change. Yes. But the sad part is, for the most part, we're really not willing to do what we really need to do to change. What does that mean? Does that mean we like us just like we are? I don't think so. I don't think so. Fact is, I think that's why we make so many commitments. We don't like what we are. We don't like what we've become. We don't like what we are becoming. They say that most New Year's resolutions last just over a month. A month. What time of the year are most wedding proposals made? What do you think? Wedding proposals. I love you, I'm engaged to you. What month does that mostly happen? Would you believe January? It kind of shocked me. I think of those spring months where they have most of the weddings, I guess. But it's in January. I mean, what woman would not enjoy a ring on her finger? And not to mention, you don't have to spend all that money on all the other gifts. What better way to begin a new year than with a person you love. Plan a wedding. But here's my question. Of those who go through with the engagement, how many of them would like to have a new beginning again after a very few years of marriage? New things give us the opportunity to start over. A new job means you have a challenge to do better than you did last time. A new job is a second chance. And at this time of the year, you have, of course, all of those New Year's resolutions. New beginnings. New beginnings. When you think about that, have you ever wondered what it would be like to start over? Everything. Just start over. I mean, a new start with a clean slate. A new start. Here's what I believe. I believe that's exactly what God gives us when we enter into a personal relationship with Him. A new start. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. I believe what this is saying, no matter what your past has, no matter who you've met and run into in your past, what you've done in the past, no matter. No matter how many times you messed up, no matter how many times you failed, your slate is wiped clean. You have a clean slate. Old things have passed away. No matter how good your past is, no matter how bad your past was, you have a new beginning. You can start over. Forget 2023, 22, 21. I'm starting over today. This is my new beginning. So today, you, if you're within the sound of my voice, I don't care if you're sitting in church or a living room or wherever, you can have a new beginning today. All you have to do. Enter into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's it. I don't care about resolutions. I don't care how many you've made. I don't care how many you've broken. It doesn't matter. That's the only thing that matters. If you have never had a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, don't leave here today without one. I feel like a salesman. And I guess I am. I'm trying to sell you something. We don't have to make new commitments. We don't have to make new resolutions. We don't have to go through all of that New Year's stuff, have a few drinks to top it off. No. If you really want to start over, if you really want to wipe the slate clean, accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And that's it. one time. My time occurred on June 22nd of 1988. Nothing about January in there. I'm just telling you today because it reminds me of a New Year's resolution. What if you had a perfect New Year's resolution and you made it a whole year? What do you get? What do you get? But if I make the greatest decision that I'll ever make, and if I accept today Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, kaboom. They should shoot some fireworks. It's that big of a deal. It's that big of a deal. You never have to worry about it again. You never have to be burdened by it again. You can walk out of here and say to your spouse or nobody, it doesn't matter, just say it to yourself. I'm saved. I'm saved. That's the best gift that I can offer. Nothing compares to it. Salvation. That's the best. Now let me add a couple of things. So when you receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, guess what? You will become a new person. You're not going to change a lick on the outside. It may not be as great as you thought it would be. But 3 months from now, it may hit you like a ton of bricks. I'm really saved. I'm really saved. And so that's what happens. You become a new person. Listen, I've seen people accept Christ as their Savior and there's no change in their appearance. But then there are some who are very, very quiet and reserved before Christ as their Savior. And now they're outgoing. Always got a smile on their face. And then you have those who had addictions to drugs or alcohol, who leave it all, and they never have a craving again. I've seen people who were bad spouses, bad parents, just bad people. And yet, when they gave their life to Christ, they changed. They became a new person. People have come home a new and better husband, a new and better wife. Kids, all of a sudden, love mamas and daddies, because they became new people. And even though we are not saved by works, our works should be proof that we have changed. And you will change. Simply put, God needs to rule your heart. If God rules your heart, you can be okay. I had a friend, not a dear friend, but an acquaintance. And he got saved when he was, I think, 20 or 21. Lived like Satan had broken into a liquor store. I mean, he was drunk all the time. Running around doing crazy stuff. Faithful to his wife, believe it or not. But he was horrible. Horrible. Awful guy. And then about 15 years ago, this guy turned 70. So you're talking about 50 years of living like hell. And finally, in a church one night, he went forward and he said, "I'm tired of living like this. I got saved when I was 20 years old and I gave my life to the Lord. And then I ran off and left him. And I'd like to go back." And he did. He is alive today and a witness to Almighty God.
Amen.
A witness in a way, I don't want y'all to be a witness, but still a witness. He said, "I threw away 50 years of my life. I'm not throwing any more away." Yeah. I just encourage you to get into God's Word, read it, and apply it. And it will make a difference. You don't have to listen to someone's teaching or preaching. You can do it on your own. And encourage each other. The Bible talks about singing songs, not to each other, but sing them to the Lord. Can you imagine how many bad voices he's heard? Huh? Man alive. Unbelievable. And then I believe we're supposed to commit to everything we do or say to Jesus and continually thank God for all the good stuff he does for us. I believe that's how we're supposed to live as this new person. But God knows our hearts and he also gives us new starts. You ever wished you could have a new start, a clean start? You ever just kind of daydreamed about that? A new start, a clean start. You see, even after you start that new beginning with Christ and become that new person, doesn't mean you're going to lose that sin nature that haunts us all. But God, in his grace and glory, knows exactly that. So he made a way so that when we stumble, we can have a new start in order to experience the true joy. In other words, not having any guilt. God made a way that we have a new start and have forgiveness every time we stumble and fall. And if we say, like the Bible says, that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. We all sin. And we're all going to continue to sin even after we receive Christ. God tells us how. He says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Yeah. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive those sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. All unrighteousness. You know what that means? A new start. A new start. But first, you got to have that new beginning. We have to become that new person. And when we stumble, which we will, and when we fall, which we will do, we can start. start over. How? How do you start over? Give Jesus your life. That's what it. I don't know who's got a hold of it right now. Just give him your life. Take your life out of Satan's hands. Out of Satan's hands. Give it to Jesus. That's it. Give it to Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity that you give each and every one of us. I pray that we will act on it today. Amen.